my favorite combatants in life, and welcome to another episode of Everything Combat, because yes, life is a fight. Tonight we've got one hell of a guest coming on with us, an old friend of mine, and I'll bring in my co-host, the genius, Jeffrey Wilson. How are you, buddy?
What's up, brother? I am good, man. Every single day above ground, a good day. I'm anxious to chop it up with this cat. Quite the prolific filmmaker. He's been responsible for a lot of films I like, you know, 2 Days in the Valley. I really like that Don King doc, or it wasn't a documentary, but the movie Only in America he did for HBO back in the day. So you done killed it. You done slayed another dragon, brother.
He took some heat for that one, by the way.
Did
we'll
it?
Talk to him a little bit about that. Yeah, also the life and death of Bobby Z, just called Bobby Z.
The flick you were in, I know you're not going to mention
Paul Walker film.
It. Yeah.
Which was an amazing time, had a good time. And so anyway, you know, what we're going to be talking about, obviously, is his career, his life, his trip from out east as a kid, making his way out to Hollywood, making his way through life and turning things around for himself and seeking fame and fortune out in the Hollywood Hills.
But sounds like it.
Yeah.
Recent film flick was with his very good friend, Sylvester Stallone.
Best buddies.
Yeah.
Best buddies.
Going to get into it. He actually did a documentary a few years ago on like the making of The Expendables, which I got to see because our last week's guest, Randy Couture, that whole franchise is just really sweet, all the players involved there.
Could I just landed one spot in that?
That's like, what I'm, this is you your know, boy. That's what I'm wondering,
just the kid, dude. The kid washing their cars or something.
You and know? I'll even be a stand-in for Pat Miletich.
You'll take getting kicked through windows and stuff for me.
I'm a stunt double like our boy Roy Markham. Shout outs to Roy Markham. What's up?
Roy Markham's he's an actor. He's not a stunt double, buddy.
Not a stunt double, but he started out, I think, in the stunt kind of business. I'm sorry, Roy, if I'm incorrect.
No, I got him a part in that film.
Well, there we go. There we go.
We did the fight scene with Paul Walker. We all died in the desert at the hands of Paul Walker.
So are we getting a call in from him? I'm sorry, Producer Jay. Is he going to? We going to do the Skype? We're going to do the Skype. All right, just stand by. We're going to lock in.
Try and hook him up here. That would be nice.
And this, so you got him a role in the movie, and you didn't get yourself a role?
No, I got thrust into this because we'll talk about it on we'll talk about it on here when we get going. Trust me, because it was quite a good time in the Baja Mexico region of that country. It was crazy. It was absolutely crazy. We're talking about federales robbing the crew, the producers, the directors.
What?
Yeah, they went after Robbie Lawler, myself, Tim Sylvia, and Sam Sheridan, and we're gonna rob us. Brought us back to the police station until they realized who we were, and Tim Sylvia started swatting their arms away from him. It was getting real close.
We were about, it sounds real close.
This was all going down 40 miles from the Mexican border. So I said, and we had just heard stories that day of people who had been incarcerated in Mexico for nothing, and then their families had been basically robbed. You know, just keep sending money to get them out of jail, and they wouldn't let them out of jail. So it's just their way of you know, pilfering money out of people. And I said, listen, if they try to arrest us and take us in the police station, they're all getting knocked out, and we're making a run for the border, boys. We're making a hot run for the border. So it was going to be pretty interesting.
Getting tense.
Very, very tense. I'm not a big fan of the country of Mexico, I can tell you.
No donkey shows for the corrosion sensation?
This is terrestrial radio, for God's sakes.
I mean, you know, like an equestrian show, you know, like... But yeah, we'll be talking to him.
You are a clown.
I am not.
You are a clown. So yeah, we're going to get him on Skype here momentarily, but this show, while we've got time, brought to you by chemicalfreebody.com /farmer. Again, chemicalfreebody.com/farmer. Type in farmer as your promo code, get discounts. If you've got, look, autoimmune disease, if you're, you know, obesity, energy problems, anything that you've got going on with your body that just doesn't seem right, look, go to chemicalfreebody.com. You can even get personal coaching from Tim James, the guru, to fix your physical ailments. So
we got Tim James coming on very soon. He was just on Dave Clark's podcast today. We are Superman, but I think we got our guest on the line here, John Herzfeld. Pat scored a monster today. Here we go.
John Herzfeld, are you there, my friend?
How are you, Pat?
I'm doing great. You are here with my co-host and I, Jeffrey Wilson, and I'm pumped to talk to you, my friend.
How are you, sir?
Hi, Jeffrey. How are you?
I am fantastic. Absolutely. It's a pleasure to talk to you, sir. I was a big fan of 2 Days, or The Valley and the Don King movie. You are the man.
Thank you. I really appreciate that.
So Jeff was pumped. I told him who we were going to have on the show tonight. And he said, "You're kidding me, dude. You hit a homer." So he's pumped. He's a fan of your work. So
I'll try not to let you down.
I'm also in SAG. If you ever need a really handsome, caramel complected fella to just look really cool on set, sir.
That's good to know. Good.
Yeah, he is pretty talented, John. I will say that. John had to coach me a lot on the set of Bobby Z with the Paul Walker film. I just couldn't seem to get things right in the acting realm.
It's not easy, man.
Well, I didn't understand, you know, a lot of the lingo. Let's put it that way. But anyway,
okay.
You know, John,
don't be hard on yourself, Pat. You did it. You're great.
He always does that. He's modest.
He was destined to be on camera.
So when you and I first met, John, let's talk about that first of all. I mean, you've got an awful lot of accolades to discuss, and we're going to go through that stuff. But how I met you, I believe you gave me a call and asked about coming out because you were writing a screenplay about mixed martial arts, about a story within mixed martial arts. And I believe it was the Fertittas who might have been having you do that at the time. But you came out to Iowa, spent some time with us, did some fun, hardcore workouts, jumped in, fit right in, and... And really, we had a lot of fun that first time.
Oh, I loved it. I had a great time up there. I mean, come on. I sat there and worked out with you, with Tim Sylvia, Matt Hughes, Robbie Lawler, Jens Pulver. What a time. What a terrific time.
And you made it into the 100-pound club, which, for people to understand that is, and you can't even go to lunch with us if you don't even get into the 100-pound club. If you can't, right? You don't even get to go to lunch. Unless you can do the 100-pound club thing. And so everybody grabs dumbbells, and with one arm, you grab the heaviest dumbbells you can, and you throw it up on your shoulder, and then you have to press it above your head and lock it out and hold it. And if you can't at least do 100 pounds, and it's a competition to see who can lock out the biggest dumbbell over their head. And, you know, Rob Lawler, Hughes, all those guys, obviously very powerful guys, they were throwing up 150-pounders, you know, pretty well. But you got into the 100-pound club, and you weighed about 145 pounds probably at the time, I think, John. I mean, you're not a massive human being. And we were so damn impressed with what you did. You know, it was you definitely earned your stripes with us. I said, this guy's hardcore. But now what's crazier is you wanted to prove yourself to be tough so badly. And look, you're not a spring chicken. You're a little older than I am. And you destroyed your shoulder doing it, and you had to have surgery because of it, right?
No, not because of that.
Okay.
There was no way I was not going to do that. There's no way I'm standing around you guys and not getting 100 pounds. I would have died on that floor before. But I ruined my shoulder from just working out too hard and, you know, probably a little bit of age in there, but I'm all right. I'm still doing well. I mean, you can ask Jay Glazer. I did about 16 windmills at his gym about 10 months ago.
Nice work. Nice work. And I will point out to the listeners that your son, who is a bear of a man now, right? He's a big, big guy. He was a heck of a wrestler too, right?
He was a great wrestler in high school. He was a heavyweight champion in his junior year and a light heavyweight champion in his senior year. And you'll see him because he's in my next film. He has a little role, and
nice. He's
about 240, really built, strong, and he does a good job. Yeah, he's always a big boy.
Yeah. Now you just got done with the project, also with your childhood friend, best buddy Sly Stallone. You know, mm-hmm. I've had conversations with you a couple times, and you've put me on the phone with Sly Stallone a few times, and that was quite an honor, just knowing that you guys are best buddies and all that stuff. And Stallone asking me questions was kind of overwhelming. You know, it's like Sly Stallone's questioning me about mixed martial arts. But you just directed a film with him in it. He's obviously the star. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that project?
Okay, it's called The Extractors. It comes out this summer from Lionsgate. It's Sly, Dave Bautista, and a phenomenal new mixed martial artist from China, Max Zhang, who is tremendous. And it's a sort of a sequel to the first Escape Plan, but it's so different that we're calling it The Extractors because it's about a group of guys who break into a prison to break people out. And the prison we shot in was actually the prison they used with Shawshank Redemption.
Oh, wow.
In Mansfield, Ohio. And we actually shot inside the prison. I think they shot mostly exteriors. Amazing, haunted place with a story in every cell. Unbelievably horrific conditions. And it was a great experience. We shot all nights. And it's a lot of action. And there's some, I think there's some really strong fights in it. And Sly, I think, gives his the greatest beatdown he's done in movies. He'll tell you. He beat this guy at the end, the bad guy, played by Devin Sawa, tremendous actor and a tremendous fighter, got in great shape for his fight with Sly, and quite a beatdown. I know that Sly put an Instagram out last week, a little bit of it, but it's coming at you.
Yeah, you pointed me towards that. I went to Sly Stallone's Instagram, and you go down about four rows. It's on your left-hand side. And it looks like a brutal fight scene. I mean, it's very well choreographed, very well put together. But he's, I mean, this actor's actually taken some bumps for Sly on this one.
Oh, my God. Well, when you see it, basically what we did was this. I worked with a stunt coordinator. By the way, one of the greatest stunt coordinators. His name is Clayton Barber and Justin Wu, two guys who did small movies like Black Panther, and then they did our movie. And we worked out this fight scene. And then, with the double, and Sly comes in, he looks at it, and he goes, okay, forget it. Forget all of it. I want to really give a beat down. And we, Sly talking to the other actor, and Sly got in there, and he said, he put his two cents in, and he did a tremendous job. And you'll actually see 1 minute without cuts of him beating this guy down. So you can tell there's no cuts to make the fight. Him straight, the fight lasts longer, but there's a full minute with no cuts.
Which is incredible. In modern day film, that sort of thing doesn't even remotely exist. I mean, usually it's, when I count camera shots, it's usually 1001, 1002 switch, 1001, 1002 switch, right? It's that quick. So a full minute of the same camera angle is insane.
No, if 1001, 1002 is slow. I mean, sometimes you just see cuts that are literally eight frames.
I've been hit a lot, John. So slow, yes, but
no. What I mean is slow, meaning
no.
That,
I don't.
No, and also this fight takes place the denouement, the climax, in a 7x9 foot prison cell, and it's the real cell, and the walls are the walls, and these are not padded walls. So when you see this, it is what it is.
Brutality, bouncing off of concrete, smashing into it, getting crushed against it, all that. Yeah, it's, well, we're pumped to see that. The Extractors, that's going to be a great one. And Batista actually had an MMA fight. You know, it's been several years since he had his MMA fight. He fought for the Birchfelds out in Providence, Rhode Island. I know Jimmy Sr. and Jimmy Jr. very well. Great promoters, great people out there on the East Coast. And Batista did his MMA debut out there. He ended up winning the fight, but you know, he found out that MMA is pretty difficult, and acting, while though very difficult, at least someone's not actually trying to take your head off. So he's done a good job in acting. I'm sure he has a good role in that movie.
Oh, but, where do you see his fight?
Where
do you see his fight? Oh, my God. He fights a guy that's as big as him, and it's actually a guy who doubled him in several of his movies, and it's his friend, so they work together.
Cool.
And he's huge, and it is... Dave is great. Dave is.
That's awesome. That is awesome. So I like telling the stories, and, you know, we can talk about it a little bit, but, you know, you get called to replace the director on a movie called Bobby Z, The Life and Death of Bobby Z, based on the book, The Life and Death of Bobby Z, starring Paul Walker. The Lawrence Fishburne's in it. The Carradine brothers are in it. There's all kinds of big names actors, and you call me up and you say, hey, I want you to gather up some fighters, some guys that, you know, look good on camera, some good athletes, whatever, some of your name guys, and we're going to come bring you down here, and you guys are going to do some fight scenes, some prison scenes, some fun stuff down here on a movie set, and you're going to help choreograph these fights. And I went, okay, this is a little overwhelming, but I'll do anything for you, John. And you brought us down to Mexico, and I tell you what, I think that was one of the funnest times that my guys, Rob Lawler was there, Rory Markham, Tim Sylvia, Ben Rothwell, Gann McGee, Chuck Liddell, a bunch of MMA guys that you brought down there.
Wow.
Yeah, you know what? And obviously some of the really good stuff didn't make it in the movie. because I have a disagreement with the producer. And so one day they'll release my version. But, yeah, it was a thrill having you guys down there. What a team. What a team.
And the fun thing about that was the interesting part, you know, we're just fighters. We're just fighters, and we're down there, and we show up. And come to find out, you know, a lot of the people don't even – they really didn't even want to talk to us. And I think that they were intimidated that, you know, Jim Sylvia, Ben Rothwell, who are monsters of human beings, and I think they were probably a little intimidated. But later on, when we're almost done with our part of filming for 5 weeks or whatever it was, Tony Adler and some of the other people – Tony Adler was the assistant producer, if I'm right, or – AD, assistant director.
I think he was the assistant director.
Yeah, so anyway, he said, you know, when you guys showed up, everybody was terrified that you guys were going to hurt all the actors. All the fight scenes, everybody was going to get hurt. And then come to find out, you guys were actually, I mean, fine in all the fight scenes. You were pulling all your punches, missing your targets on purpose, and doing your thing. And they said, you guys actually having real fighters on the set, actually, they said made it one of the funnest movie sets they'd ever been on. And we had an absolute blast down there.
Yeah, and Paul loved you guys. I mean, Paul was extremely enthusiastic, and he was quite knowledgeable about the game.
Right.
I think the producers didn't quite know what it was because it was so early on, and I was trying to explain to them, and I don't know if they ever quite understood, but Paul did, and... that was great having you down there.
Yeah, it was a great experience for me. I always appreciative of that. Now, let's talk about your beginnings, buddy, and how you ended up in Hollywood and doing the things that you've done. I mean, you come from Newark, New Jersey, and you know, a hardworking family. Your father set an example for you as a hardworking guy, and you know, take us from there.
Well, I was blessed in this fashion. I knew from 8 years old on I was going to do movies. No one, I just said, I'm going to do movies. I'm going to be in movies. I'm going to write them. I want to direct them, even though I didn't even know what a director did back then. I wanted to do movies, and I never went off that path. Now, my father, who is a great man and a World War II hero who saw some incredible action, he understood, and he brought me to a lot of movies, but saying, you're a kid from Newark, New Jersey, saying, I'm going to be in the movies, and it's okay if I fail math and fail science and fail foreign languages and fail history and geography because I don't need to know that. You know, it was a little tough for him, and I bounced to schools and briefly went to a school for, quote, wayward youth before that didn't work out. But I always knew I wanted to do movies. You know, I think when I was 12, I saw Spartacus with Kirk Douglas.
Awesome.
And
nice.
And that movie, which I've seen maybe 70 times, that was my path. And, excuse me, so this is how I started in the movies. I actually started, after doing a lot of extra work, you know, I got a tiny part that got me noticed in a movie called Death Wish.
Charlie Bronson, yeah. Baby.
Yeah.
Well, I'm the subway mugger who tries to kill him in the subway.
Nice. And,
you know, I ended up on the poster, even though I don't have a credit. So I'm the guy that tried to kill him in the subway. That got me noticed. And that got me noticed for an old series called Kojak. I don't know if you remember Telly.
Oh, Ball. You know it. Baby. Yeah, buddy. Come on. Telly.
Yeah. Telly. So I was in the pilot called The Marcus Nelson Murders as an actor, as a cop who gets shot and killed. And they liked me, and they'd seen Death Wish, and they said, let's bring you out. And I came out and pretty much guest starred in Kojak, $6 Million Man, Squitch, you name it. Basically, a whole bunch of shows.
Nice.
And then I got I started writing. I'd always wanted to write a script, and I got lucky, and I sold the script to MGM called Voices. And literally, at the time that I sold the script, I was cleaning ovens. They would take an oven from a condemned building, and the guy would pay me $10 and give me a Brillo pad and say, you get $10 for every condemned oven that you can clean. And that's, I was broke. I had nothing. I was living in a one room with a couch and a chair.
Let all the listeners out there who ever hear this, listen to what this man is saying about cleaning ovens for $10 per oven. And how long did it take you to clean one oven? The condemned oven.
About 2 hours an oven.
Yeah, so you're, and that's not easy work. It's filthy work.
No, are you kidding? It's filthy. And not only that, it was horrible. I mean, I literally reach the bottom. But I leave there and I write. Every night I write. I write. And I wrote this movie. And I actually wrote a movie based on it, inspired by an incident. I had been in New York. And in New York, I was coming up 3rd Avenue after getting fired from a waiter's job at a restaurant called the Honey Tree. And it was about 7 o'clock, and a bunch of kids came running down the street, and they're going, and they're making strange noises and grabbing me. And it took me a few minutes to realize that there wasn't anything wrong with them. They were deaf. And they pulled me around a corner where a woman was being mugged.
Oh, wow.
And you know, I didn't know what to do. So what I did was I threw a garbage can at them, and they ran, luckily. The woman turned out to be a teacher of the deaf. And,
oh, wow.
You know, she thanked me. She said, you know, come to the school, and the kids want to thank you. So I walked over, and I suddenly became exposed to this world of a deaf, the world of deaf, which I had no knowledge of. And so that inspired me to write a movie about a deaf girl that falls in love with a singer. Amy Irving started it. Anyway, so I went from basically a guy who had nothing, maybe $80, to my name, to getting a check for $100,000 from MGM to making my movie.
Well, so that's incredible.
That is incredible.
And the first thing I did, thank you, was I Xeroxed the check and sent it in the mail to my father, who always thought I would maybe not amount to much out here. And that got me going. And from there, this is a really strange path, a lady came to me, a producer, and said, do you want to direct? And of course, everybody in Hollywood wants to direct. I said, of course. And she said, if you write an after-school special, I'll get you to direct it.
Stoned.
After-school specials were those movies you come get 3 to 4.
I used to watch them.
Okay, well, I did one called Stone.
Yeah.
About a kid who's addicted to weed, and he gets stoned and ends up getting a boat accident. You know, they had to have a moral lesson at the end.
Right.
And believe it or not, I got lucky, and I won the Emmy for the first time out, and that kind of got me on my way to directing.
Pretty incredible stuff. Now, all these huge things that we're going to talk about that you have done and accomplished, to me, you have to understand that my favorite show, childhood show growing up, was Starsky and Hutch, and you
he was in it, wasn't he?
He was Starsky's evil, you were Starsky's evil brother, yep. Right, twin brother that he didn't know about or whatever.
Shut up. That's
he looks
right.
Like it. Yeah. He looks right. Like
it. Oh, it's all coming together, Mr. Herzfeld.
The whole show. Oh. Now Pat, Jeffrey, here's a great Hollywood story.
That's awesome.
This is a great, I star in Starsky and Hutch. I think I'm off to the races. I'm gone. I mean, this is the greatest thing. Not only that, it's the last show of Starsky and Hutch. So it's, you know, the last, and they're finished their season. So I did it, and I get a call from my cousin from Washington about, 3 weeks later, and he goes, John, congratulations. He's screaming. He's popping champagne. They're spinning you off. You're doing a series. You're starring Starsky's brother. I said, what? He said, yes, it's a cover of Star Magazine. I said, what? I hang up. I run to the newsstand. And there I am in the cover of Star Magazine. Starsky's brother, John Herzfeld, 20th Century Fox, spinning off the series. I'm ecstatic. I run to the phone. It was pay phones back then. I call my agent. Get the agent. I tell the assistant, get him on. Get him. And I said, this is great. This is amazing. He says, wait a minute. What are you yelling about? I said, they're spinning me off. Starsky and Hutch. I'm going to be Nick Starsky. He says, what are you talking about? I said, I'm on the cover of Star Magazine. And I'll never forget what he said. He puts me on hold a minute. He comes back and he says, John, do you believe everything you read in Star Magazine?
Oh.
There was no truth to it. I went to 20th Century Fox the next day. I went to the offices, which closed now. They said, are you spinning me off? They go, no.
Wow.
Not at all. So that, you know. That was one moment, and then you come crashing down.
Wow. Yeah, that had to have been tough. Like you said, you thought you were on top of the world there. I have to tell you, man, of all your credits, this goes back, two of a kind. Olivia Newton-John, John Travolta, one of the best scenes is when Olivia Newton-John is in her acting class, and John Travolta's in the audience. She's like, you bastard. You imbecile. And she looks and sees John Travolta. She's like, there he is, because he was
That's
the one.
Worst Australian accent I've ever heard in my life,
I'm sorry, but it was just fantastic, because they were like, when she was like, oh, my God, there he is. She's like, oh, my, they're like, oh, my God, you're acting so well. But she wound up seeing the guy who was part of, I forget what it was, that he had, anyway, that, I'm just going back and remembering Lane on you. But that was a great movie. Great two of a kind, Olivia Newton-John and John Travolta, classic flick.
Thank you. That was fun. And the acting teacher in the show was a real acting teacher, great guy who still, I think, coaches Viggo Mortensen these days, Warren Robertson. So the guy in the acting teacher was the real guy.
I do have to ask you, because, I mean, I graduated from Columbia College, kind of film school, and, you know, throughout my years, you see a lot of directors and auteurs have to, like you just said about Bobby Z, it's like you want to be able to show your version sometime, and always when you go into it, the vision you had going into it is oftentimes never what's put on screen. How difficult is that as someone who has a certain vision, especially as a screenwriter, producer, director, to have to, for lack of a better term, kind of compromise to get a version of what you want on screen?
Okay, I'll answer you. No one's ever asked me about this, and I think it's time. I've never seen the movie. What happened with Bobby Z was...
I don't mean necessarily just that movie, just your visions in general, any of your projects.
Okay. Well, you know, it's like anything else. Every director on planet Earth goes to war. It's like going into a war to complete your vision, to do it in the time allotted, to not go, you know, over budget, to cast it right. You know, it's always a war, but it's a wonderful war. Sometimes, you know, it works great, works out great, and sometimes it doesn't. I think, most directors will run into this at some point in their career. Like 15 Minutes and 2 Days in the Valley and Don King Only in America, those projects, you know, were wonderful. And, it all depends on too. You need a great producer. And the one coming out with Sly, I'm very proud of. You know, we got a lot in there too. But, you know, you do the best you can. It's always a war.
And you have to have
going to war.
You have to have a common goal, a common vision with the producer to ultimately get what you want, right?
Yes. The producer has to know what it is that you want to accomplish. And so, you know, what a director tries to do is really articulate what they want to do, how they want to do it with, whether it's storyboards or visual boards these days, or
and whether it's
explaining.
More and whether it's to pull something off costs more money, the producer has to approve it, right?
For sure.
Always.
Right.
Money is always an issue.
Yeah.
Well, and if something that comes to mind, something that comes to mind is the basically the war to make The Godfather between Robert Evans and Francis Ford Coppola. And it's so weird how that tumultuous relationship, because they obviously just did not get along, created one of the most classic films. So even within that,
can I tell you a Godfather story?
Absolutely,
we'd
sir.
Love that.
Okay, I'm an extra in The Godfather. As a matter of fact, in the scene where Al Pacino is walking down the street with Diane Keaton, and he looks over at the newsstand,
yes,
and he finds the paper, Vito Corleone feared murdered.
Yep.
Okay, I was dressed as a Navy sailor. I'm not in the cut, but I was on the set. And I shouldn't admit this, but when we called rap, when the AD said rap, I looked around, and I saw the stack of papers. I saw the Vito Corleone feared murdered. I took it. I have it.
Do you still?
I have the newspaper that Pacino held in his hand saying Vito Corleone.
What? Wow. Wow.
That might go for a little bit at auction,
yeah,
huh?
You think?
Can I give you... Oh, my God. Can I give you... But if you're talking about how to make it and how not, let me tell you another story, because this is how kind of it began for me. And this is interesting. I went to... When I got out of high school, I got on a plane to come to Hollywood because all I wanted to do was the movies. And I basically graduated with maybe a D average at best or D minus. So I couldn't get accepted in any college. I came out, landed L.A., hitchhiked up with my suitcase to the Sunset Boulevard because back then, you know, Sunset Boulevard, that's where you go, right?
Right.
I get to Sunset Boulevard, get out of the cab, and oh, my God. Right in front of the Whiskey A Go-Go, there's a movie shooting. And I go, oh my, this is destined. This is bigger than me. So I hide my suitcase in the parking lot behind the Whiskey, and there's a crowd, and I sneak my way into the crowd, and I move my way up to the crowd, and I see this little guy, not this little guy, this actor come out, and the beautiful actress comes behind him, and they argue, and they're looking, and suddenly a guy comes up to me, and later I realize the assistant director, and he goes, "Hey, you smoke?" And I said, "Me? Smoke? Yeah, chain smoker. I smoke all the time." "What do you need?" He goes, "Listen, take a cigarette this time, smoke the cigarette. When they come out, you know, laugh, turn to your friend and laugh. Then relight the cigarette, smoke. You're going to be right on camera, the three of you." "Okay, great." The guy next to me turns to me and goes, "Wait a minute, who are you? You're not with us. What are you doing here? What are you doing here?" And I said, "Man, don't say a word," because I thought it was definitely.
So cool.
I said, "Say a word, we're going to have trouble. You're going to have big trouble. You not say a word, you know."
I'm a New Jersey guy. Don't you just shut your mouth?
Yeah, I said, I really threatening look. I said, "Get away from me! Don't ever say anything." And we do it a couple of times, and then do about three takes. And the assistant director comes over and he goes, "You know what? Very good. We're going to give you we're bumping you up to Simon Business. Can I have your let me have your waiver? You know, your little card that you fill out to be an extra." And I said, I think I left it in the car. And I'll never forget, the agent looks at me and goes, and he realizes, are you with us? And I said, it's no problem. I don't care. I don't need money. I don't want to be paid. And he goes, "My God, you know how much trouble you'll get me in? You're on film. You know, they'd already wrapped." He goes, "It's you and our stars." I said, "No, it's great. Just tell me, what's the name of the movie?" Because I didn't know the actors. And he said something I didn't understand, high school graduation or something, and I didn't know what it was, and I wrote it down. And he said something like, "Dirt something's in it." I messed it up. And, of course, the movie comes out, and it's The Graduate, and it's me, Dustin Hoffman, and Catherine Ross.
that's so incredible.
And that's me, you know, you've seen The Graduate, me sneaking in.
That is sick.
Wow.
That is sick. That's a great story.
That really is
a great story.
Wow.
You know,
those little happy accidents, man. It's weird how the universe just kind of puts you in certain places at certain times, and you, sir, have clearly made the most of it.
But you have to force the action. You have to force accidents. You know, in this, the movie business, you got to find a way to push through or break through or sneak through or get through that crack in the door.
Fortune favors the bold, baby. Fortune favors the bold.
In everything.
Yeah, correct. So, John, I've got to tell this story, and I'll tell it as abbreviated as possible, because we're down there in Mexico in the desert, up in the mountains, and we're and there's a massive, massive forest fire going on off in the distance in the desert, the High Plains Desert in Baja, Mexico. And we're doing the fight scene in the desert, Rory Markham, Rob Lawler, and myself fighting Paul Walker, and it's a shot over a couple of days. But anyway, Rob Lawler had died the previous day in the shooting. In the shooting of the film, and I am up on top of the rocks, those big giant boulders, talking to you about the fight scene for that day, and that's when Rory and I are going to be killed. So anyway, Mike Gunther comes up, and he's at the base, and we're 30 feet up in the air on top of these rocks, and Mike Gunther, the stunt coordinator, who's an incredible guy, by the way, incredible stunt coordinator, and he's now directing movies. But anyway, he says, "Pat, you need to come down here." And I said, "Well, hold on. I'm talking to John Herzfeld right now. We're discussing the fight scene." He goes, "No, you need to get down here now." So I had to get down there and get down to the to him real quick. And he said, "Rob Lawler is about to kill the assistant director." And I went, okay. This is not good. And this doesn't reflect on any of you, but the accounting department wasn't paying a lot of the people on the set on time. And so they were, I think, 4 to 5 weeks in the rears to me, hadn't paid Lawler yet, hadn't paid some of the cameramen and some other folks on the set, and people were getting a little angry about it. So anyway, I come up upon Rob Lawler standing over Tony Adler saying, "You know, Pat's not getting paid, the cameramen aren't getting paid, these people aren't getting paid." And he said, "I'm not laying in the dirt." He goes, "My best friend's fighting right now. One of my best friends is fighting. Matt Hughes was fighting that week. Up in Salt Lake City or wherever in the UFC." And he goes, "I'm not going to go over there and lay in the dirt for you when you guys aren't paying us on time. And I'm just not going to do it." And Rob was getting pretty heated. And I said, "Rob, just go ahead." And Tony Adler actually took his walkie-talkie and said, "Hey, Jim, Get Rob Lawler's SAG paperwork up here real quick. And now Rob Lawler doesn't care about a SAG card, which everybody in the acting world, that's all they want is a SAG card. Right. That is like life.
Gold.
That is gold, yes. So anyway, Rob goes, maybe you didn't hear me. I don't care. He goes, you're not paying people. There's going to be an issue. And I said, all right, Rob, just go ahead and go walk off into the desert, cool off. And I looked at Tony Adler and I go, Tony, as you can see, Rob's not quite as patient as I've been, right? And this is I'm a guy who is, you know, the accounting department, the accounting guy has said week after week after week, yeah, Pat, the money's getting wired into your account, wired into your account, wired, and it never happened, right? So anyway, I come up upon Paul Walker's, and this is more a testament to how Paul Walker was a genuine human being. And I walked up on the rental Suburban that he was in, and he was with his driver, his buddy, and Rob Lawler was sitting in the back seat, and all the windows were down on the Suburban. And Rob said, you know, this is a make-believe world. Actors live in a make-believe world. We come from a real world, and the money's not going into our accounts, and we have bills to pay, and something better change pretty quick. And Paul Walker turned his head sideways, and he said, wait a minute, what? And Rob said, nobody's getting paid. Nobody on this set's getting paid. And so Paul goes, all right, hold on. So Paul gets out of the vehicle, goes walking up to Tony Adler, and he literally said to Tony Adler, he said, Tony, he said, if these people don't get money in their bank accounts by lunchtime, we're packing up all the semis on this movie set, and this movie is done.
Whoa.
And that was his ultimatum. And Tony Adler instantly started profusely sweating and realized that all hell was about to break loose in his world. And he scrambled to make that happen. And the funny thing about this is, John, and I hate talking right now because I want to talk to you, but they wired accidentally $350,000 into my account when they owed me $35,000. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And so I held on to $350,000. And the accountant who'd been bullcrapping me for, you know, 5 weeks kept calling me every day and coming to the set and going, hey, man, you got to wire that money back. You got to wire that money back. And I said, listen, dude, when I get confirmation that everybody on this movie set has been paid in full, you will get the money owed back to you. And so finally, one of the cameramen, who was actually from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, contacted me. He was the last guy that hadn't been paid. And when he paid, got paid, then we wired the money back to the company. But it was just a great turnaround. But that was more a testament to who Paul Walker was.
You know, Paul, first of all, I'd never heard that, but that's a great story. Second of all, Paul was a great, what a down-to-earth, real, authentic guy.
Yeah.
And the thing that hurts me is that he gave a tremendous performance in my film.
Yeah.
And the producers, took it over, and I don't know if you know, the producer started to direct scenes behind my back, the action scenes, which were some of them not very good, and I had defined my career on action,
right?
Which is why I ended up going to the DGA and saying, this is my movie and theirs, theirs. And the DGA, which never does this, put it in front of a panel of very well-known directors who said, your name's off the movie, because I was that upset with it and all the shenanigans that were going on that happened to you. That happened to you once. There were other stuff that was not good. And literally, they were supposed to, I said, put the producer's name on it. He directed some of this stuff, which I don't like and will not stand for. And in any event, they put it out anyway. And what was I going to do? But yes, Paul, 100%, great guy. It was, you know, God bless him.
I graduated from Columbia. I did production for several years, started as a PA, and was on a set. And it seems like, is what Pat just described, basically, is that the kind of, and I don't want to get you in trouble, but is that kind of the exception of the, or the rule sometimes?
When no exception.
Okay. Because
no,
I just know no. A lot of producers, like, no. They want to do everything on the cheap. They want to spend the least as possible, even if it is, you know, at the risk of upsetting, you know, guys like Pat and Robbie. So I just wanted to know how much for you that was like an exception or the rule to the game.
No. It's the exception. You know, when you know, every movie you fight, you use every dollar you can to put on the screen. Every director wants it. You'll put all the money on the screen. You want to get the biggest bang for the buck. You want to come in, you know, on budget, so, you know, the studio will be happy with you. But, you know, and oftentimes, I have to say this, oftentimes movies that are extraordinarily chaotic come out great.
Right.
So it's not a,
yeah.
It's not a rule of thumb. Sometimes you see a movie, they go, well, it was the greatest movie, had the greatest time in the world, but you know, I just finished reading The Making of the Wild Bunch, which came out few weeks ago. And The Wild Bunch, for me, is the greatest Western ever made, and I love the movie. And the backstage stories of that movie are, some of it's crazy, but, you know, so no.
Yeah, that's very similar, you know, to like the Godfather, Coppola, you know, Robert Evans kind of conflict, which created magic.
But take for example, Don King, Only in America, that you mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
That was produced by HBO. HBO produces so many good movies. Why? Because, one, they care, and they have great leadership and management and executives. But also, you know, they are so supportive of the director and its and their product. And the reason why they keep making one terrific movie and series after the other is that's how they work. So, you know, so that was a great experience. And so it's the exception. But you know what? Today, the movie business is changing. You have many, many huge movies, and then you don't have a lot of mid-level movies anymore. They don't make, you know, when I was growing up, you had a million dramas come out. They don't, there's not a lot of dramas. Those are on Netflix and Amazon and HBO. So, guys that make independent movies scrape for those dollars.
I remember there was a great documentary on Netflix about the Golan Globus guys and just some of the great, horrible movies they made back in the day, like Break In and Missing in Action. But yeah, those kind of studios like your Lionsgate and your Fine Line Films or things like that, or Miramax, you don't really see a lot of that as much anymore, as opposed to some of the, so much of the bigger budget stuff. And so much is made outside of Hollywood. Like stuff that's made in Chicago or Louisiana or North Carolina or Georgia. It's really kind of, like you said, it's changed quite a bit.
Yeah, and you know what? The great thing about what's happening now is people are making movies everywhere. You know, you can make a movie however you can make it. You know, you pull it together. There's so much talent in every community, and people are so movie savvy. You know, it's a great time for movies. I think it's always been a great time for movies, but now I think more people can get access to make films quicker and easier and faster because they just can.
Ask you, per that statement, and this is something I've noticed because, you know, the internet and everything is, you know, the whole digital world has really changed everything. What do you think young up-and-coming filmmakers should concentrate on more? The content, the writing, the acting? Or, because it seems like everybody's like, no, I can't do it unless I have the big budget and all the lights and all the crew, when award-winning movies are sometimes shot on iPhones, etc. So should there be a balance, or which comes first there? Content or,
I'm going to tell you what I think. One word. Passion. What story can you tell that nobody can tell as well as you? Hmm. What's in your heart and your guts and your soul? What is the story that you want to tell? Because you'll tell it better rather than imitating or trying to do some version of some other movie that you like best. What do you feel in your heart and soul? Put that, whether it's on an iPhone or whatever, put that on film. You know, get local cast or whatever you do. Put something that you care about so deeply. That's what I'd say. And those are the guys, or those are the gals, that make it, because they work from their guts. And that's what I suggest. And my other suggestion, which is, and sometimes when I speak at schools, this is what I really believe. I think today, what's maybe not done enough by filmmakers is live a little before you make a film. Meaning that whatever films I've made, or whatever films a lot of my friends, whether they're older or younger, experience life. In other words, live a little. Don't just make movies off watching TV and other movies. You know, live. Like, I dropped out of college and traveled the world for a year and slept in doorways and train stations and fields where I woke up and there was a cow pissing on me in the south of France. But, you know, and I've done a lot of crazy things. I've done some crazy things with my old buddy Sly. And we lived.
Right.
You know,
right.
Some things I wouldn't talk about and some, but that gives you the fruit,
yes,
and the grain and the soul to have experience.
Yeah.
So what I'd suggest is get some experience, whatever it is, whatever you like, because that'll inform your writing. It'll inform your personality. That's how you find out who you are and what you want to express on film.
You know, and this may be, I don't know how to interpret this because I'm not within that, you know, movie, TV industry, you know, creation group. You know, you've been part of that family for so long because of putting out so many great movies and TV shows. But, you know, we're hearing about, you know, with Netflix and Hulu and all this other stuff that is now on the rise, people can produce and direct and create movies specifically made for those platforms for a lot less money, all that sort of stuff. And we're kind of along the same line as Jeff's question, but we see some big name directors and producers who are kind of ticked off about all of this stuff because of their ability also to win, you know, some big awards, some big movie awards, where it seems a little bit like, you know, the old boys club of Hollywood is a little ticked off by some of this stuff. I mean, and if it's a borderline question for you, you know, to answer, I get, but you know, it does seem a little bit like the old guard, the old boys club, you know, is a little offended by some of this stuff.
Yes and no. I'll tell you why I think it's yes and no. I mean, first of all, it's an inevitability. You can't fight it. Netflix is doing so much. Amazon is doing so much.
Right.
And that's the world in which we live. I mean, look at Roma, all the accolades it got, all the awards it's won, and that was funded by Netflix. And he's one of the greatest directors of our time at the moment, and he went to Netflix. And I'm sure they gave him everything he needed to make the movie that he wanted to make. And I don't know if another studio was going to let him make a movie like Roma. So, you know, yes, okay, you want everybody wants their movie on the big screen. I want my movie on the big screen. But you know what? Sometimes it'll happen, sometimes it won't. And what do you want ultimately? You want to communicate your movie. You want people to see your movie. You want eyes on the screen. Now, whether it's a television screen or not, you know, I mean, there's so many great stuff on TV. By the way, I have to put this word out. I don't know if you guys have seen the series Get Shorty.
I have
you
not.
Probably have.
The movie I've seen, but not the series.
Okay. The movie, you know, the movie's great. The series has nothing to do with the movie.
Oh.
But I just watched two seasons in the last, I think, 72 hours.
Went on a little bender, God. Did you?
Oh, my God. Is that show great? Is that show great? And what is it? It's being made for Epix, which is the division of Lionsgate. It, I guess they want to start their own channel. So it's a little hard to get the second season. You have to actually do it through your iPhone. At least I had to. But
they want to start their own streaming channel?
I believe so. And the show's great. If you want to see a show that really gives you some insight into Hollywood, it's about, you know, gangsters that come in and don't know anything that end up killing a guy and they take his script, which they don't even know what a script is, and then they end up starting to take over Hollywood. Great series.
Wow.
Great. I have nothing to do with it. I don't know anybody involved in it, but I loved it.
Speaking of scripts, and this is kind of a funny story, and this will tell you what this kind of encapsulates John Herzfeld's honesty and frankness. And I was kind of inspired by a lot of the stuff that he talked about. And I had this idea, you know, and I didn't have script writer, knew nothing about the software program to write, you know, scripts, anything like that. So, you know, all the stuff that's put in for you, exterior,
yeah,
daytime,
exactly.
You know, all that sort of stuff. And so I wrote like 5 pages or something on an idea that I had. And I sent it over to John, and I wanted him to look at it, and had no clue whatsoever how to write a script at the time, and still, you know, don't. I've worked on some other stuff, but I sent it over to him, and I go, so, you know, what do you think? And he goes, it was terrible. He goes, I go, well, how terrible? He goes, it was awful. It was ridiculously
brutal
bad.
Honesty.
He goes, just tear it up and start over. Just tear it up and start over, dude. He goes, that was awful. He goes, I read about half a page into it and just, it was done.
Well, wait a minute.
To quote Dionne Warwick, that's what friends are for.
I got to qualify by that. I write, and listen, I've written 50 pages of something, and I realize it's not going to work. You know, I'm specking a script over the years, and I've written, and I go, I'm never going to really get this one right. And I throw it in the garbage. Every great writer, I am sure if you interviewed them, will have that. And they go, you know, this one doesn't work, and you got to move on.
Right.
So I wasn't telling you anything that I haven't done myself. I can empty the trash out. And
I loved your honesty though. You just right away. It was terrible. It's terrible. Just stop.
That's awesome.
But Pat, you got a great story, my friend. Just you as a story. What you came from, you in Bettendorf, Iowa. You know, when I came up there and watched you work and watched how you related and how you communicated, and don't think I wasn't watching every bit when I was writing that UFC movie. It was fascinating to me. It's fascinating. And that's why, remember I told you way early on, you belong on camera. How many times I text you while you're doing your shows, you know, and I'm always watching you. And the way you learn to relax and start to own it and take over. I knew you were on air guy. I knew it the minute I met you. I said, this guy belongs, you know, in front of the lens.
Well, I appreciate that, John. I really do. And, you know, what I would love to hear about, you know, you're always writing. I know that. You're just constantly writing. Ideas are streaming through that mind of yours. And I'd kind of like to know, you know, what you're working on now, you know, and obviously you can't go into details on things, but, you know, I'd love to hear about kind of your visions for the future and what's going on.
Well, I'm doing something that all your listeners probably should not do because it's really stupid and moronic, but you have to go with your guts. I'm writing a story about my father, World War II story, because it's so deeply personal and because it's just crazy. My father passed away 4 years ago. The day before my father passed away, my stepmother said, your father was delirious, he was 95, and he started mentioning something, I don't even know what he was talking about, something, you know, fighting up to his knees in mud, thousands of men around him.
He finally brought out the story of the huge battle.
Yes, and he started, and I was writing, go, Hurtgen Forest, and I go, what is that? I don't even know what it was. It was a battle in World War II, actually the longest battle in the history of American military. We lost more men than we did in Vietnam, by some accounts. And to make a long story short, I started ordering books off the internet about anything I could about my father's company, and he was in this, you know, he was actually in the 2nd Battalion, 330 Regiment, 83rd Division. And
yeah. And what forest was this again?
Hurtgen Forest.
Hurtgen Forest.
Story.
Where is that located?
I order a book. It's on the border of Belgium and Germany.
Okay, good. All right, go ahead.
Guys are passing. So I order a book off the internet called Entering Germany because of the first guys who got into Germany. And because I, you know, and I buy a great World War II photographer. And I look at the book and I turn to the first page, I turn to the second page, and I literally, my heart dropped. This is my father.
Wow.
I'm looking at the book right now.
Wow.
It's my father with the author of the book. The photographer. And I said, what? I track him down. His name is Tony Vaccaro. He's 96 now. He was a war photographer, and he had a great career after. Make a long story short, I say, I finally get him on the phone, and I say, my name is John Herzfeld. My father was a Lieutenant Henry Herzfeld. Did you know him? And there's a long silence, and I can hear heavy breathing, and then he starts to sob. And he says, I'm 95. I'm in Long Island City. You better get here now. I get on a plane, first plane in the morning. I go to Long Island City. I go in this man's studio. I said, you knew my father? He said, I knew your father since D-Day. He's my commander. He saved my life.
Wow.
I said, wait a minute. I don't. My father never mentioned D-Day. I don't think he was there at D-Day. And he looks at me and he goes, you silly boy, you don't even know who your father was, do you?
Wow.
And he pulls out boxes. He had literally hundreds of boxes of negatives, of pictures he'd never even printed.
Amazing.
From 50 years ago. He takes out one, he puts my iPhone over it, you know, over a light box so I can see the picture. There's my father and him, another picture. And he says, you know where your father was? I said, well, I knew he was at Dachau. And he goes, your father was at Normandy. He was in the hedgerows. He was in Hurtgen Forest. He was at Dachau. He was in the Brenner Pass hunting Nazis. He was in, your father was active in the Nuremberg trials before, during, and after.
Wow.
Your father became a military guy. He told me things. I'm literally in the chair. I'm going, what? He never spoke. And he goes, you know what your father did after the war? I said, no. And he starts showing me pictures. My father was also called up in 1952 to take part. And he was saying, it said, take this oath in private, send it back to this address, and you'll get your next appointment. I'm still trying to figure it out. I used the Freedom of Information Act, and they said that his files burned up in a fire in 1956. But the bottom line was, I found a whole other side. And what my father went through at this Hurtgen Forest is an amazing story of triumph in a war, in a battle that was quite amazing. So anyway, that's what I'm working on.
Is that going to be a part of the story of how that was kind of this hidden history of your father that came?
It gets better. I called my stepmother and I start telling her all this. Did you know this? And she said, Tony Beccaro said my father was at Normandy. And she said, would he ever talk about Normandy? She goes, no, only when he gave speech there and he had all the people, they all cried. I said, what speech? Where? And she said, did he even tell you we went to Normandy? He spoke there. He talked about it. I said, no, he never told me anything. And she said, you know, I have a box here that I think we have to give you. He had this crate. I opened this box up. There are 500 to 600 pictures, small pictures, like an inch
today
by
in
two
school,
inch,
I learned a lot.
That he had some the war photographer took and some others took. And it's him, a Forrest Gump. He's got pictures when Europe and Germany surrendered May 7th in France. He's there. He is Dachau. He is Nuremberg. He's everywhere. And I said, what is this? You know what I mean? Wow. What is this? And then my wife and I went to Germany a few months ago, and I wanted to retrace his path. So I get a German guide who's actually son of a Nazi officer, and I get an American guide, and all they do is guide you for a couple of weeks. And they go, do you know, he says, well, let me take you where your father rescued a company, and there was a writer in this company. I said, a writer? What do you mean? He says, well, where you're standing, and he just shows me maps and coordinates and graphs, and he goes, this is a company, there's a writer in it, your father, he got them, they were under fire, and that guy was named J.D. Salinger.
Wow.
I said, what?
What?
And the catcher in the rye. Salinger catcher in the rye.
He had short stories with him that he carried during the war.
Yeah.
And Holden Caulfield was in there. I said, what? They're going to never mention that? No, it gets better. Then we
this
go to
is
a church.
Hey, John, and I hate to do this, but we have literally about 1 minute left on air here. And this is the most amazing story.
I know.
And we got
I'm about to get to Hemingway. To get to Ernest Hemingway.
Hurry, 30 Let's seconds. 30 seconds.
Go.
30, I'm in Boston next. The guy points to a church. He says, you see that church? He goes, yeah, that was the command post for your father. Do you know who's there at the same time writing a short story for Collier's magazine covering the Hurtgen Forest? I said, no. Who? Ernest Hemingway.
That's awesome. That is awesome. And you know what? There are so many American heroes. And you think about your father, not only the pride of being an American hunting Nazis, but being a Jewish American hunting Nazis, just a badass American doing his thing, going
badass
after those guys.
A Jew.
And we love it. We love it, John. Wow. And I love you, buddy. And thank you so much for coming on. We're looking forward to, we got to have you back on and we got to talk more.
Thank you
love
so
you.
Much, sir.
Yeah,
thank you
so
very much.
It really went quick. And I'm here for you anytime. And I'm a big fan of both of you. And Pat, you're the man, brother.
Thank you, brother. Tell Sly we said hi.
I'll give him a big hello.
All right. You take care of yourself, John.
Thank you, John.
All right.
Thank you. God bless.
Thank you, sir. That was director, actor, producer, John Herzfeld, writer, extraordinaire, amazing dude. And this has been another episode
breathtaking
of Everything
episode.
Combat. Jeffrey.
I'm speechless, bro. I can't wait to see that movie. That's Forrest Gump Part 2, like you said.
We have guests.
You brought the unbelievable pain this week, champ.
That was fun. So
awesome sauce.
Gosh, I just love being... I love doing this. Bringing positive news to the world, buddy. This is what our...
And he started from such humble things and look where he went.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Radio
Never quit.
Sports Center.
I'm John Brinkley. The last time LeBron James missed the playoffs, Zion Williamson was 4 years old.